My name is Rolf Blankenmeier. I'm from PwC. No worries, I'm not an auditor. I work for the advisory line of service, to be more specific, in the CEO advisory team. And I focus on enterprise architecture. And enterprise architecture for us is really the linchpin between strategic topics, managerial topics, and more execution-related topics, because it really brings together IT and making sure that IT delivers value to the business. We offer different kinds of offerings around that topic. So one is to build up the architecture function as such, to build transparency, preferably with using Linux. We build architecture roadmaps, target architectures, and so on. And one further service offering is application rationalization. We are doing this either solely within the CEO advisory practice, but we also work very closely together with our colleagues from the transactions unit. So very often as part of mergers and acquisitions, where two companies come together, application rationalization is being applied in order to bring the two landscapes together and then make use of all the synergies everybody's hoping for. So most of the times, application rationalization is really one project which has to be delivered within a certain time frame. So having a good application landscape also means that over time I have to work on this. It's also involving portfolio management, where I set up processes in order to identify what kind of building blocks I want to have in my landscape and whatnot. But usually if we talk about application rationalization, there is a certain demand, a certain need to rationalize the application landscape. So one, for example, could be I have a merger and I want to reduce the redundancy and functionality I have. So this is very classical. But what we also face very often in recent times is that companies want to reduce complexity. They also want to move away from a very monolithic ERP system, and they want to go to a more microservices-oriented architecture. So this could be another driver for application rationalization. And then the third very large driver we see very often in the market is, of course, that people simply want to reduce cost because the technical debt has increased over time, and they want to free up resources in order to modernize the application landscape. In order to do this, they first of all want to simplify and shrink the overall landscape. But application rationalization is not only about costs, because it's both the business and the IT, they benefit from this greatly. And in order to sell this to the business or to the project sponsor, for example, or to the CIO, we can see that application rationalization is also like a prerequisite for digitalization. So if I look for the different benefits I get out of that, for example, classically I reduce costs, which is always a good thing, but reducing costs also means that I free up resources. I free up money, which I can use in order to invest in new technologies. If I streamline my application landscape, can also mean that I harmonize my processes because I have more applications from a certain vendor, for example, which is using a more unified process model, which also makes it easier to exchange building blocks in my application landscape. I reduce the technical debt, also means I have more resources freed up, so not just in terms of money, but also in terms of people, or in terms of a technology I have to care for. If I have a lower variety of technologies I have to maintain and support in my company, that also means I can focus on lesser technologies and skills, on a fewer amount of technologies and skills. So I can train my people for new technologies, new topics I can enable in my IT. If I have less applications, that also means I increase my agility. So for example, I once worked for a customer, they wanted to extend the material number from 6 to 10 digits, and they had to do changes in 100 systems, which is not very unusual, but you can imagine this very simple change really has an effect on many, many systems. So this simple change becomes very, very expensive in the end. Yeah, and if I have simplified my data model, so for example, I have not too many different applications which have different kinds of data models for the different objects, it also makes it easier to exchange applications, to exchange building blocks, or to exchange an on-premise application with a microservice, for example. So all these different benefits really make it possible that I engage myself and open myself for digitalization-related topics more easily. So this is what the overall process looks like. I will walk you through it step by step. So we start with setting the target. Important here is that this is very closely aligned to my IT strategy and to my architectural principles, architecture goals, which I hopefully have already set up. And then, of course, it's very much based on collecting a good amount of data I can use in order to base my decisions upon. And this is where especially a tool like Linux comes in very handy, because it allows me to collect data in a distributed manner. I can really involve my whole IT organization in collecting data, which speeds up the whole process. Because collecting data is always very cumbersome. It's something nobody wants to invest in, but this is really absolute key. So my last project, I was forced to use Excel. I know what I'm talking about. We really spent a lot of amount of time just taking together data, keeping it updated. Then you have different kinds of Excel sheets. You need to consolidate them. It's really a huge waste of time and effort and motivation of the people, to be honest. Yeah, and the outcome basically is, first of all, that I identify those applications I can immediately, or let's say in a short-term perspective, decommission, and other applications where I need to do some investment in order to modernize them or in order to make another application fit so that I can shut down the old application. So I have some things I can really do within the scope of this rationalization project. That means I can shut off applications. And then I have something like, let's say, initiatives or project proposals, which would then feed into the portfolio management process. Okay, so let's have a look at the process in detail. As I said, we start with setting the target. So here we can really be very creative, and it really makes sense to have a variety of different kinds of KPIs which I can link back to my strategy, or even better, to my architecture goals. I have direct KPIs. So I mean, the classical one is to reduce the number of applications. I mean, this is pretty clear. I can also measure the run costs, which ideally should go down after the exercise. I can also say I want to reduce the amount of vendors I have in my landscape. And I could also have the goal that I want to have more off-the-shelf products than have so many custom-made software. In addition to that, so I can have rather indirect KPIs. For example, I could measure before and after that initiative the average usage of an application. So that should go up naturally. I can also measure the business satisfaction, which ideally should at least not be negatively impacted. I can also count the different release versions I have of software. And I can measure the adherence to architecture principles. Not sure if how many people are doing this currently, but ideally I can really measure this and then see that I'm more compliant to my architecture. So, once I set the goals and I really know what I want to achieve in the end, I need to collect the data. And here, basically, what I need is two kinds of data, two kinds of fact sheets, to use the Linux speech. First of all, of course, applications and also capabilities. As you all might probably know, creating a digital capability map can be very cumbersome, because you have to convince the business, you have to do this, then they ask why, we have processes, why do we need capabilities, and so on. So this alone can take a certain amount of time. So we as PwC, of course, we have reference capability maps, so we can use these in projects in order to accelerate this process. They come in different flavors, for different kinds of industries, but it's really meant to kickstart this. We don't want to spend 3 months just talking about the capabilities. We want to have something very quickly in order to base our discussions upon. When I've got this, I will also collect then the applications, which I, in this context, I would always do this in a collective manner. So I would really spread this out. I would make every application owner, every business owner, to be responsible for their application, for their kind of process area, and maintain their applications. I also need to be clear about the attributes I want to maintain. So I've listed just a few, like licenses, run costs, number of users or logins. Is also something can be difficult to get them, but it's really worthwhile to invest this effort. And then I have a good set of data in LeanIX. The capabilities. Again, I should make the effort and rate these capabilities, whether they are differentiating, commodity, supporting, or just have two categories whatsoever, because this helps me in order to identify redundant applications per capability. But I can also take different measures depending on whether I'm looking at a commodity or more a strategic capability. You will see this later on. So now I have collected, hopefully, all my applications. And especially in large companies, this can mean I have hundreds or if not even thousands of applications I have to go through now. So what we need to do is I need to slice the elephant. I need to reduce the complexity also in my task. And there are different means I will apply. So first of all, we start. The idea is basically I want to reduce the number of applications for which I have to do a very detailed scoring. Because scoring is very cool, it's very objective. I can very easily argument why an application is better than the other, but it takes really a lot of time, and I really get lost in detailed discussions very quickly. So what I need to at least try to do is to define guardrails. So a simple one could be, I don't want to have any local CRM systems. I see skeptical glances, so of course it's very difficult to just say, I don't want to have this kind of applications. It's very difficult to push this decision through. So there are some things. So first of all, it's very important to have very strong management buy-in for this. There are some things I can really strictly demand, but I can also have rather, let's say, soft guardrails. So I can say, I want to have no local CRM systems. Or as a management team, I assume I don't need any applications with less than 10 users. So that doesn't mean I automatically shut down all the other applications, but it means I reverse the burden of proof. So that means now I don't ask the business users, okay, just tell me what don't you need. Instead, they need to come to me and they need to justify why do they need the application with less than 10 users. Maybe you run your homepage on that, your internet page, and there's only the administrator logging into it and the rest is anonymous internet users. Of course, would be a very good reason to keep this kind of application. But you get the idea. You need to tackle this from different kinds of angles. Then, in order to further reduce the set of applications I'm looking at, is I select those capabilities for which I assume that they house the highest potential for rationalization. And then the next is I build application subsets according to different criteria. Let's have a look in detail. So if I want to formulate these guardrails, now I can utilize my capabilities and the categorization of capabilities. So for example, I say, according to my architecture principles and guidelines, I say that all my applications which support differentiating capabilities, I don't really care whether they are on-premise or cloud environment. I just want to have the best fit application. But I give a slight preference to use custom-made software because I really want to have the best there is, and I really want to tailor this to my specific processes because this is something where what sets me apart from the competition. If I look at the commodity applications, I can have a completely different setup. For example, I say I only want to have cloud SaaS applications, and it should be off the shelf and only centrally used. I don't want to have any local deviations from this. So that would mean, for example, I look at e-commerce. I have identified e-commerce as being my differentiating capability. And if I am in the context of a merchant acquisition, for example, I could say I always prefer those e-commerce related applications which are from the buying company, for example, which makes the decision a lot easier. And all the commodity applications, I can say, okay, I prefer only applications which are cloud native, for example. So then the next one, the capabilities or process areas, whatever's there. Ideally, I would use capabilities, but not every time we have them, unfortunately. So if I look at the different kinds of process areas or business domains I have there, I can really rank them according to the potential they bear for application rationalization. So I have areas, for example, like corporate reporting or corporate finance. I mean, this is about really bringing data from different areas together. So naturally, the business, it's in their own interest to have not too many applications because they want to have a consolidated databases to make decisions. On the other hand, changing these kinds of applications doesn't really put my company at risk. While when I look at software for my site operations, MES software, or everything I need to have for my warehouse, for example. If I change, first of all, it's very complex to change it. If I change it and something goes wrong, this has immediately a negative impact. So this is something I would really rather touch in a separate exercise, but not really in a rationalization exercise I want to finish within 12 months. So using Linux, then we can also use this in order to easily identify the applications I want to look at. I can tag them, whatsoever. So now that I further reduced my the amount of applications, I also look at certain subsets. So for example, I look at those applications in capabilities where I normally would not expect lots of local applications. So like CRM applications, everything which is sales related, analytics applications. So I look for all analytics, sales, CRM, whatsoever applications which are local. So this is also another subset of applications I can have a deeper look at. I can also look at the most expensive applications, everything which costs more than 250,000 euros a year, for example. I can also look at applications, for example, MDM systems, middleware, learning management systems. There's no reason I have a plethora of applications of these types, basically. So I should really select a strategic solution and say, this is the solution I go for. I can also say I can look at those applications, as I said before, with less than 20 users and so on. So I build different subsets, and this I can use this in addition to the capability view. I can use this in order to refine this capability view. Depends a bit on the company and on how many applications I'm looking at. And of course, we have intersections here. So this is really, I'm looking from different angles at the problem now. So this is now where I talk to Linux, and it's not productive, but we thought about, okay, how can we best support this with Linux? And we came up with some extensions of the data model. So for example, we can now tag all the applications and say, does a guardrail exist, yes or no? Because I'm assuming either there is a guardrail or I do my my detailed scoring. So I can select guardrail yes, and then I can say whatever kind of guardrail applies, which I have defined up front, of course. If I select no, then there's another area popping up there when I can do my scoring, which you will see in a split second. Here we go. So if I want to make my scoring, so we as consultants, we sit together with a client usually. We have, of course, plenty of question catalogs we can discuss. We see what is best fit for the client. And we, of course, try to make a link between the enterprise architecture principles to these questions. So yeah, very simplistic examples. So if I have an enterprise architecture principle saying strive for standard software where possible, I could add the question whether something is ready-made or to what extent it is ready-made or it's off the shelf. And if I say my principle says treat data as an asset, I can write to what extent does the FAIR data approach apply to the data I have in an application. So we collect all the questions. We do a weighting, of course, so that some are more important or have more impact than others. These questions usually, I mean, this can also be defined per customer, of course, but usually we separate them in three different areas. So we have budget-related questions, we have functionality or business-related questions, and more technology-related questions. So, and then I can use my subscriptions, and I ensure, if I don't have it already, I add them different stakeholders, so people who are functionally responsible, budget responsible, or technically responsible, like the release manager, for example. So, and then I can use another standard functionality, the survey. So I pick each of the roles, and then I select those questions they want to receive so that the business responsible only gets the functionally related questions. Yeah. He gets an email, he clicks on a link, probably you know that feature already, and then directly in Linux he can do that writing. So basically what he's doing, he's entering the data directly on the fact sheet, so right away I can see the result in the fact sheet. What we also need is the business criticality, which is also a standard field, so this is also something we need to maintain in order to get a nice time quadrant of Gartner filled. Here you go. I don't know if you have seen this already, so this is, I think, pretty simple and brilliant at one time. So Gartner says, okay, we have a quadrant, as usual, and in order to identify those applications which are good candidates in order to decommission them, I have basically two dimensions. I have the quality and I have the business value, or here in Linux speech, it's called business criticality, so I simply use this standard field. And the quality is put together out of the results of the technical health and the functional fit, so all the technically and the functional related fields. There is a new feature coming up. It's called computed fields, which allows me to pull together data from different source fields into a new field, and then it can also consider the weighting, for example, and then it simply aggregates the results of the scoring so that I have a technical health and a functional fit, and this then aggregated into quality.
Yes.
And the computed fields is a feature of Linux, so it will become standard. The graphic, if you have a deep look, you see it's PowerPoint, it's not a screenshot, but this is also something we are going to incorporate into the Linux solution.
How do you handle the subjectivity in the survey? If you have a lot of application owners and they might put different meaning in one, two, three, four stars.
So, yes. So here you can see we have explanatory text for each rating. Due to practicality, I usually only describe the one-star rating and the five-star rating, and then offer the option to add some text why the certain rating has been incorporated. If you get so much feedback, really depends on really the mass of questions you send out. But it's very important that you explain what does the lowest and the highest rating really mean, so that everybody knows what it means. You don't come around discussing this in the end. So there always is some subjectivity, of course, in there. Right, and that's where we are then. So we have these soft guardrails, so things where you want the business to justify why they want to keep certain applications. This is something which has to be discussed in workshops. And then the scoring, of course, has to be normalized. And we also, I mean, we need to take our conclusions and then capture in the life cycle what exactly do we want to do with the application, do we want to decommission it or not. So it's not something we can automatically derive, it's something which has to come out of discussions and workshops. How these are set up is of course very individual, so I thought about coming up with a recipe or different kinds of patterns, but I really left this out. Instead, there are some lessons learned I took away. So in general, we can say, We have lots of pushback. So first of all, if you want to make these bottom-up scorings, assessments, you talk to people who are normally fond of a certain application. Maybe there are even people involved who develop this application, either from IT side or from business side. So they have a strong backup within the company. People will also fear that they lose their jobs, as a matter of course. What you also have is that people don't know who will take the cost of the decommissioning, because this also has or comes with some investment. So first of all, you need to make the succeeding application fit to carry over the functionality of the old software, and you also need to archive the data potentially. So if you just ask people, what do we want to decommission, they will first of all just step back and then first of all ask, okay, who's going to pay for that, because they're afraid that they have to pay it out of their own pocket. So this is something I have to make sure up front, who is going to pay for that. Ideally, it's something I can pay at least for some applications within these initiatives, so that I can say I want to have a return on invest within 3 years, so that I can at least tackle the most urgent cases. So this is something which really has to be communicated up front. And then you will... I mean, it's a very nice idea really coming to a consensus, have some democratic approach, and then everybody agrees on what really don't we need any longer, because now we won't all go cloud native and so on and have everything containerized and so on. But in the end, you will not come around a very strong top-down approach. There has to be managers with a steady hand and an iron spine who really stand behind these conclusions and who say, I want to get rid of certain kinds of applications. You can also use us consultants, of course, to blame us. But in the end, the final decision can only be made by some managerial levels within the client. And this is very, very important, and this is something where the process usually struggles. So, once I have now come to a conclusion, I have had my discussions, I had a look at the scorings, And what I did in the end is I updated the application lifecycle. So I marked all those applications which I want to decommission, those which require some further investment, and so on and so forth. What I now need to do is I need to set the roadmap and prioritize it. So that means I need to find out what really are the benefits and how easy is it in order to achieve these benefits. So first of all, what are the benefits? The benefits are quantitative, so it's in the end the run costs which are incurred currently by the applications minus the archiving costs. So here it is very important that I make up my mind, do I need to have archiving? How do I need to archive this? So in a large program, for example, it could make sense that you have a center of expertise, lawyers, whomsoever, who is a central point of contact, who can answer these questions, who can say, this is personal related data, so you have to purge them. This is data which is subject to legal hold, so you need to store this. And you don't need to store it just somewhere. We have a dedicated archiving solution. You can also think of, do I already have a central archiving service? Do I need to acquire an archiving service from a system integrator? Do I need to build something like this? Do I need to physically archive something, for example? Because this really has a huge impact on the business case in the end. And then you have the implementation cost. So if we have a merger, for example, or where we have a situation where we have a lot of redundant applications, it can be quite easy because at least from a very high level view, we can say, okay, applications covering a certain capability, they more or less have a similar set of functionality. Of course, I need to do some investment, but from a high level, I can already foresee how big will this investment be. So I can at least see which applications can I quickly decommission and for which applications I really need to take a lot of money in my hand because I need to acquire a completely new application or I need to make a succeeding application fit. Then I have the strategic value add. So this gets a little bit fluffy, of course. So I can say, okay, I'm replacing my old IBM iframe by a SaaS application, hooray. So this is now very compliant to my enterprise architecture vision. So I can give it some points in regards to qualitative benefit. And then I need to see how easy is it to capture this benefit. And this is basically determined by the dependencies. So if I need to implement a completely new application, I have a new dependency because I need to wait until this implementation project is finalized, for example. It could mean I have to modernize or change my product data model, for example. It would be another dependency and so on. So these dependencies, I have to rate them so that in the end, I can then score basically the ease of capturing the benefit against the benefit itself. So in the end, what I end up with is I have a lot of some applications which are redundant, which I can easily replace. So this is everything I would say I can tackle with in my rationalization project. Then I have applications which also have redundant functionality, but I still need to do some enhancement in the succeeding application. And then I have other applications where I really need to invest some money. I need to modernize them or really exchange them with something new, or exchange an on-premise application with a set of services or something like this. And this would be something I would capture in a project initiative. And I would hand this then over to the portfolio management. Any questions so far? Yeah?
Maybe you will explain the logic, but I would slightly disagree with this up circle in the left high benefit, yeah, this one.
Yeah.
Because if it's high benefit, then why are you putting it on the long term?
Well, it's high benefit, but it takes a lot of time in order to realize this. So it's not something I would do within this rationalization program, because normally, I mean, your mileage can vary, but normally this rationalization program is something which should be finished after a certain amount of time. So I say I have this program. I finally have convinced my CEO in order to sponsor this. So I invest some money. I let it run for 3 years. I want to identify applications I can decommission or I have to modernize, and I at least want to decommission those within the scope of this rationalization program which create net savings within, for example, 3 years. And then the rest I would give this into the portfolio management. And if I see I have a structural problem or there are, I don't know, so many applications coming out every year, I really need to think of, okay, how can I optimize my portfolio management process? You have a question?
What's your time horizon for the savings?
The what?
The calculation of the savings.
Yes.
What's your time horizon? How long do you actually spread the implementation costs? What makes logic and the
capture? So logically, it's a good question. So the buy-in you can get more easily for a time horizon like 2 to 3 years. This is realistic, I would say. Yeah. And then I would do this a second time and a third time again, but because you need to, it's very, first of all, you will face a lot of resistance. It's something which is not so visible. It's also very fluffy because these, as I said, archiving costs. It's very difficult to calculate these. Also, the implementation costs you will have to cover. It's also very difficult to calculate these. So you really should focus on a more or less short time frame in order to get some positive results. And then you have better backup to do this a second time again. Yes, please.
Yeah, hi. Can you hear me? Good. From where do you get all these cost items? Is there a cost model behind? Do you use another tool?
Yeah. Yeah, it's very tricky, yes. And this is something which can which decides whether this business cases can be created or not. So it's you can benchmark this, of course. So we can benchmark this from other companies we worked for. And in the end, it's really a very, it incorporates a lot of legwork, basically, going to IT controlling, getting these numbers, and so on and so forth. So it really incorporates a lot of manual work, so to say, if you want to really have a solid business case. Well, at least to those, I mean, those which have less dependencies, it could work. That's why I reduce basically the amount of application I'm looking at. But so I can't do this for all applications. But if I have these candidates with less dependencies identified, something where I can say, okay, this really makes me more compliant to my architecture strategy, or I can reduce the number of vendors, something like this, the KPIs I have defined before, then it could already say, okay, this is the amount of application I'm looking at, and only for those I need to find these detailed numbers. Yeah.
Is it possible to define this roadmap and landscape for different countries, and on roadmap to try the IT application for different countries for the company?
Yes, of course, you can do that. You need to be aware of the dependencies, of course. But if you have something which has no dependencies to other countries or to global solutions, then you could do this, yeah. Yes, you have the user groups. Yeah. So ideally, you have set up your countries, departments, and so on, in user groups, and assigned the applications to them. So by filtering, then, on, for example, the life cycle, what is to be decommissioned, you can use the tags, for example, what you have identified as to be decommissioned with a short time horizon, and then which is related to a certain user group, which represents Germany, for example, you can really narrow the search down so that you can see the different kinds of applications.
Yeah. How do you document your internal and external dependencies of your applications that you would like to rationalize?
Okay. Ideally, I have these, so most of these dependencies will be projects, which you could also maintain in Linux. I have to confess, it's something, I have a very nice Excel template for that. So, because not everything has been captured in Linux. So, I think this is something where many customers do not really fully maintain all their projects in Linux so far. They only maintain those projects which are on the radar of enterprise architecture. So you might have really a lot of projects which are not there, not yet captured there. So you still have to look into different kinds of project portfolio, project management tools, and so on.
And do you have a scoring framework how you would then categorize your internal and external dependencies?
Yes, we have. It's in a nice Excel template. Yeah. For now.
Thanks. basically you said that you let the applications to be evaluated as expert opinion. Yeah. How many people are doing this for every application? Is it one person, or are you letting to do this crossover? Because if it's my application, it is the best, especially if I'm afraid to lose my job. What is basically the fact in the merger?
Yeah, it's correct. So talking about the merger, you will have joint process teams responsible for the same process area. So they need to come and they basically cross-rate the different kinds of applications. So you need to create joint teams, basically. So in the team, everybody comes together. They have to rate their own, but also together with the people from the other company and vice versa. Yeah. Yes, please.
And if it is not a merger?
Yes, it is. Because you need to have the opinion from the people who know about that software. And those are the people who are using that. So yes, that's why you need external people who are challenging this.
So first of all, thank you for the very nice slide deck. I like it very much. Going back to the beginning, you used capabilities in the beginning a lot of clustering and mapping different things, but you as well said several times, if it is there, that would be nice to use, but sometimes it's not there. So my question is, if you go into a company, they don't have business capabilities yet, you come with a framework, but what is your storyline to the senior management to convince them that they actually should spend some time in implementing business capability framework instead of using their potentially the existing process map?
Yeah, so you are very right, you need to sell it somehow. You need to show the value, and this is why I linked the guardrails to the capabilities. You can also phrase guardrails without capabilities, basically. But this is something I would incorporate in the approach to show how does this categorization of the capabilities lead to conclusions so that you can really use this to slice your landscape into the more commodity or the more differentiating applications, which speeds up the decision-making process. So this would be the storyline then.
Being the devil's advocate, why can't we use our damn process framework for that?
Because you will have different processes which are lived in a different way but doing the same thing. So, and if you want to reveal redundancies, you need to have the look at the capabilities. Because if you look at process, the same thing can be done in a different ways globally with different names because the processes have different names, and this makes it more difficult for you to identify these redundancies.
And the capabilities cannot.
They should not, because if you, I mean, you're an enterprise architect, you know what they are. If you define them properly, if you really ask, what does my company need to be able to do in order to run its business? If you start with this questioning, you don't really end up with these redundancies.
Thank you.
And those categorization of capabilities, is it something that Gartner named a space layered approach some years back? They also had some transactional systems of differentiation. Yes. Also three layers.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. You can also use this, of course. Yeah.
No, but it looks pretty similar. Is it just PPWC use same different names for the same things?
Yeah. I mean, it all goes into the same direction. I'm not always using this. Sometimes I'm using something else because this is mostly also part of a result of a discussion I have with the client, basically.
Okay, and it was also mentioned in the pitch of your presentation about technical debt, but there was not anything about technical debt like as such per se. Do you include technical debt into rationalization? Or like maybe some application have huge technical debt and maybe kind of overcoming that technical debt is...
It could become part of the scoring. You could think of, okay, what produces this technical debt? You need to break it somehow down. So it could be because it's an outdated technology, for example. So you could make this part of the question catalog, or you could make this rated, or you could basically make the subset of, I don't know, all applications which run on a mainframe or something like this. So I think you need to define a little bit more concrete for yourself what really makes this technical debt in my company in order to identify those companies which contribute to the technical debt.
Thank you.
How are we time-wise? I think this clock, it's not working.
Okay.
Or did the time stop?
Just on time, so.
Perfect. Okay, so what did I tell you now, the last 40 minutes? What is this all about? So first of all, you have to make up your mind what are your KPIs, and you have to communicate them up front. So that you know what are you aiming for, and it's really not just about the number of applications. Be creative, think of something else than that. In addition, you need to get the right people to make unpopular decisions. This is really absolute key. I mean, all kinds of initiatives they talk about get management buy-in, of course, but here it's really absolutely important because otherwise you can't make things moving, and you will have no outcome of the rationalization initiative. And at the end, you need to make transparent how do your decisions really link to the KPIs and the targets you have set up front. And this then again also improves the buy-in of the overall company, and it also reduces resistance. And if there are no further questions, I thank you.